Good morning, everyone. A good afternoon, and welcome to Russell Temple Sunday Worship Service. Today is our Youth Sunday, and our worship leader for today will be Brother Dylan Sherman. Dylan is a junior, and he is active and very studious in his work as a disciple of Christ. So, Dylan, it is now in your hands.
Good afternoon, church. My name is Dylan Sherman. I'm going to be the worship leader for today. We'll start with a hymn of praise from the Lil Buzz chorus, followed by the invocation by Kenise Carter.
Thank you. Good afternoon, church. Bow your heads and close your eyes. Father God, we thank you for this day. God, we thank you for waking us up this morning. Father God, we thank you for lifting people up in your presence.
Great selection by the Lil Buzz Chorus and great prayer by Kenise Carter. Now we'll have the scripture by Marquita Jackson Driggs, followed by another selection by the Lil Buzz Choir.
The parable of the Pharisee and the tax collector. To some who were confident of their own righteousness and looked down on everyone else, Jesus told this parable. Two men went up to the temple to pray, one a Pharisee and the other a tax collector. The Pharisee stood up and prayed about himself. God, I thank you that I'm not like the other men, robbers, evildoers, adulterers, or even like this tax collector. I fast twice a week and give a tenth of all I get. But the tax collector stood at a distance. He would not even look up to heaven, but beat his breast and say, God, have mercy on me, a sinner. I tell you that this man, rather than the other, went home justified before God. For everyone who exalts himself will be humbled, and he who humbles himself will be exalted.
Thank you.
Great scripture reading by Marquita and Grace. Musical selection by the Lil Buzz Choir. Now we'll have the offering appeal by Brother George Hardy, followed by the offertory by the IT team.
Good morning, everyone. Good afternoon, I'm sorry. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we come, giving to you a portion of what you have blessed us with. We pray that as we go this day, this Lord, that you would just bless each and every one. Give them thanks and praise, and may that the blessing that you've given us, we will be able to share with us. Even as the blessing that you've given us. Amen. Now, to those that are here, we thank all of Russell people and all the visitors for being with us today. If you are planning on anything like you're giving $400 for adults, $50 for you for the giving today. And you have any other that you're paying on, write it on your check or put it in your app, and it will be noted. You have four ways we can give: electronic giving, Giveify, PayPal, and Cash App. Or you can mail it in at the church, 507 North Alpha Street, Alexandria, Virginia, 22314. Or you could drop it off at the church. Same address, same zip code. Or you can contact one of the stewards. And we thank you for this. All things come of thee.
Next, we will have another selection by the IT team, followed by the Anointed Word by Reverend Kevin Agee.
Amen. Hallelujah. Jesus knows all about our struggles. He will guide till the day is done. There's not a friend like the lowly Jesus. No, not one. No, not one. Good afternoon in Jesus' joy, my brothers and my sisters in Christ. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Somebody just ought to give God some praise this afternoon. Amen. We give God praise for the leadership of our youth. Can we give God praise for our worship leader, Brother Dylan Sherman? Amen. To God be the glory. We give God thanks and praise for Sister Kenise Carter with our invocation. Amen. Sister Marquita Jackson Diggs with our scripture. Amen. Praise God. Can we give God some praise for the music ministry of the Little Buds? Amen. Praise God. Oh, they were rocking it. Amen. Because of who you are, I give you glory. Because of who you are, I give you praise. Because of who you are, just lift my voice and say, God, I worship you because of who you are. Hallelujah. There's a message in that music. Amen. Singing that Jacob's Ladder, that old Negro spiritual. Amen. Rise, shine, give God glory, soldiers of the cross. Amen. We have a good time in the name of our Lord and our Savior, Jesus Christ, on this afternoon. If the Spirit is willing, we don't intend to take a long time to share the word. Amen. You ain't got to take all day. Amen. You don't have to take all day to give God praise. nor do you have to take all day to communicate the message. Amen. I want to call your attention to the gospel scripture, the lectionary reading. Sister Marquita read it for us so beautifully this afternoon. The gospel according to St. Luke, chapter 18. The lectionary reading is verses 9 through 14. Right now, I just want to call your attention to verse 14 in the New Revised Standard Version. In Luke chapter 18, verse 14, the New Revised Standard Version, you find these words. I tell you, this man went down to his home justified rather than the other. For all who exalt themselves will be humbled, but all who humble themselves will be exalted. God's word for God's people. Thanks be to God. My brothers and sisters in Christ, this afternoon, I want you to think, reflect, meditate, and pray with me on the simple thought, God exalts the humble. God exalts the humble. Somebody ought to type, God exalts the humble, in the chat. Amen. If you're with your family members and loved ones sharing a device, if you're in the same room, just touch your neighbor and say, God exalts the humble. Amen. Scripture teaches us in multiple places that God exalts the humble. Let's pray. Consecrate me now to thy service, Lord, by the power of grace divine. Let my soul look up with a steadfast hope and my will be lost in thine. Draw me nearer, nearer, blessed Lord, to the cross where thou hast died. Draw me nearer, nearer, blessed Lord, to thy precious bleeding side. And out of the words of my mouth, meditation of my heart, be accepted in thy sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. Amen. God exalts the humble. A short parable, but a powerful parable. Many of you are familiar with this story. For those who are not, it's a really simple story with an impactful, powerful message. A Pharisee and a tax collector both went to pray at the same time. Those of us who are students of the Bible understand that the Pharisees were those members of the Hebrew religious community in biblical times who were really intense of their enforcement of the law. They were students of the law. They often insisted on enforcing the letter of the law as it was written in the Hebrew scripture. Many considered themselves to be somewhat experts of the law. That's sort of a brief capsule of what Bible students know about the Pharisees. On the other hand, there's a tax collector. And the word tax collector, the phrase tax collector is often used synonymously with the word sinner, because tax collectors were actually despised. One of the reasons why tax collectors were despised in biblical times is because they often, in the interest of really not just the Roman government, but in their own interest, what they did was they collected taxes from their fellow Hebrews or for the Roman government. But they often charged far more than what the taxes were. And then they kept some for themselves and gave the rest of what they charged to the Roman government. So you can understand why tax collectors would have been so despised in that time. And you can understand why tax collectors would have been synonymous with sinners, and why tax collectors would have been, looked down upon. But my brothers and my sisters, this story illustrates the importance of humility. The Pharisee and the tax collector both went to the temple to pray. And immediately when the Pharisee started praying, what really struck me as I read this passage and looked at it again is the part of the passage where the Pharisee starts out with the prayer. God, I thank you that I am not like other people. Lord, have mercy. That sentence really caught me. God, I thank you that I'm not like other people. Are there any times when we get overconfident like the Pharisee? Are there any times when we fall into temptation to look down on other people. My brothers and my sisters, I just want to tell you this afternoon that none of us are so great at anything that we have a right to look down on anybody else. Yesterday morning, after the time for morning Bible study, I was watching a funeral service for a very well-respected gentleman, a gentleman who passed away recently at the age of 99. Those of us who listen to the CME Church Connectional Prayer Ministry prayer call at 6:30 in the morning weekdays affectionately knew this gentleman. His name was Brother John Wesley Franklin. He was known as the Dean of the Prayer Call. And it was a very unique homegoing service. As a matter of fact, his three children all eulogized him. And I remember one of his daughters, as a matter of fact, the daughter who was regularly on the prayer call, talked about one of the examples that he said is that he drove all of his children through the neighborhood where they were living when they were growing up. And he told them, "You are not better than anybody you see out here, nor are you any worse than anybody you see out here." And that's something that we as children of God should be reminded. We are not better than anybody else. And make no mistake about it, I believe that human beings are created in the image of God. All of us ought to love ourselves. All of us ought to be confident in ourselves. But by the same token, we need to understand that none of us is better than anybody else. In the Bible, the Word of God reminds us in Romans chapter 12 and verse 3 that none of us are to think more highly of ourselves than we ought. The Pharisee in this parable started out thinking of himself more highly than he ought. He started out the prayer on the wrong foot. "God, I thank you that I'm not like other people. I'm not like the thieves. I'm not like the rogues. I'm not like the thugs. I'm not like the hoodlums. I'm not like the adulterers. I'm not like the players. I'm not like the pimps. I'm not like," Lord have mercy, "I'm not like those other folks. I'm not even like this tax collector." Oh, Lord have mercy. But the tax collector, of all people, had the right idea. Hello, somebody. The tax collector had the right idea. Now, the Pharisee went on bragging about himself. He's like, "Well, you know, I fast twice a week. I give a tenth of all my income." Make no mistake about it. We all ought to practice spiritual disciplines, including fasting. We all ought to fast. We all ought to pray. We all ought to study the Bible. And I said this morning during church school, I believe in tithing. We all ought to tithe. We all ought to give a tenth of our gross income. We all ought to, you know, practice sacrificial giving. We all ought to be generous givers and tithers in God's church. But we should not do these in order to heap praise upon ourselves. We exist to give glory to God. Isn't that right? Then the little buds just sing, "Because of who you are, I give you glory." We exist to give glory to God. We pray to give glory to God. We fast to give glory to God and draw closer to God. We give our tithes and our offerings to worship and to glorify God, to praise God. Everything that we do in our lives ought to be a means of worshiping and praising God. But basically, the Pharisee, even in going before God in prayer, used this as an excuse to brag, to boast. The fact of the matter is, my brothers and sisters, none of us should brag. None of us should boast. We ought to give God thanks and praise and glory for everything that God allows us to have and for all that God allows us to be. Even if we have not committed the same sins, we need to remember that the Bible teaches us that all of us have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Isn't that what it says in Romans 3:23? All have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. In 1 John chapter 1, verses 8 and 9, the Bible reminds us that if we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. That means we all have messed up somewhere along the line. We all sinned, isn't that right? Some of us, I'm not gonna ask anybody to confess, but some of us might have sinned before we got on the Zoom for church this afternoon. Some of us might have sinned as soon as we woke up this morning. And I'm not justifying folks sinning, but the bottom line is we need to remember that we all need God's grace. We all need God's forgiveness. We all need God's mercy. Even though we may not have committed the same sins as our brother or our sister, we need to never forget that we all need God's grace and God's mercy. But the good news is in that 1 John 1:9, the Bible says that if we confess our sins, God is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. That's why when we take communion, we pray what's called a prayer of general confession, because we all have need to confess our sins. But the bottom line is, our brothers and my sisters, we need to understand that God lifts up those who are humble. I said a little bit earlier that multiple places in the scripture remind us that God indeed exalts the humble. What I'm suggesting to you this afternoon is we ought to have the mindset that the tax collector had when he went before God in prayer. I'm not saying that we should be proud of our sins. What I'm saying is we all ought to understand, as our beloved Sister Veronica likes to say, I'm a sinner saved by grace. We need to understand that all of us are sinners saved by grace. It doesn't matter whether you're the chair of the board. It doesn't matter whether you're the director of Christian education. It doesn't matter whether you're the lead usher. It doesn't matter whether you're the lead soloist, the director of music. It doesn't even matter if you're the pastor or the presiding elder or the judicial council, justice, or even the bishop. We need to understand that all of us, hallelujah, that all of us, beloved, all of us are sinners saved by grace. And we all need to ask the Lord to forgive us of our sins. We all ought to have the mindset, no matter how saved and sanctified and Holy Ghost filled we are, no matter what position we hold in the church, no matter how long we've been in the church, all of us, when we go to pray to God, we ought to have the mindset of the tax collector who humbly bowed down and said, Lord, be merciful to me, a sinner. That ought to be our mindset. Lord, be merciful to me, a sinner. God, be merciful to me, a sinner. One of the old hymns of the church just says, oh, Lord, have mercy. Oh, Lord, have mercy. Oh, Lord, have mercy. Have mercy on me. And beloved, if you look at that parable, whose prayer was answered? Was the overconfident Pharisee's prayer answered? Or was the humble tax collector's prayer answered? In verse 14, it says, this man went down to his home justified rather than the other. In other words, the tax collector was justified instead of the Pharisee. God heard the tax collector's prayer instead of the Pharisee's prayer. God forgave the tax collector of his sins instead of the Pharisee. All who exalt themselves will be humbled, and all who humble themselves will be exalted. James chapter 4, verse 6. The New International Version says, God opposes the proud, but shows favor to the humble. James 4, 6, the New Revised Standard Version reads, God opposes the proud, but gives grace to the humble. That verse is derived from the Old Testament, from Proverbs chapter 3 and verse 34. In the Old Testament, in Proverbs chapter 3, 34, the New International, verse 34, the New International Version says, he mocks proud mockers, but shows favor to the humble and oppressed. In the New Revised Standard Version, Proverbs chapter 3, verse 34 says, toward the scorners, he is scornful, but to the humble, he shows favor. That is the lesson that God has for us. Kind of like, if you'll bear with me for one of my little sports analogies, it's kind of like the athletic coach who tries to tell their star players not to read their own press clippings. The bottom line is, friends, we're not necessarily that good. Reminds me, if you're playing football or basketball or whatever your favorite sport is, whenever you beat your opponent by 30 or 40 points. You're never as good as you look when you beat somebody by that score, nor are you ever as bad as you look when you get beaten by that score. Bottom line is, my friends, we ought to all humble ourselves. The Greek word which is translated humble or humbled in the passage that we shared today, that word means to make low. Once again, in Romans chapter 12 and verse 3, the Apostle Paul cautions us not to think more highly of ourselves than we ought. In Philippians chapter 2, verse 3, the Apostle Paul cautions us. He says, do nothing from selfish ambition or conceit, but in humility, regard others more important than yourselves. In humility, regard others more highly than yourselves. Sometimes we can do what appears to be the right thing for the wrong reason. In church school this morning, we had a valuable lesson about humility. Those who were in church school, y'all read the lesson. There was an illustration before we got into the scripture with a man named Mr. Jackson and another man who was identified only by his first name, Moore. Mr. Jackson had a lot of money, and he believed that if he could drop his money, he could buy himself a little power and position in the church. So Mr. Jackson had buku bucks. He was bougie, as they said in the old time slang. So Mr. Jackson dropped buku bucks in the mission ministry. But Warren actually went in the mission field. Warren actually went and ministered to the folk in the mission field with love. Mr. Jackson, the bougie brother, dropped the big bucks to the mission ministry, but Warren went and lovingly served in the mission ministry. And when it came time for the church to nominate and vote on a new member for the mission committee, Mr. Jackson just assumed that he was going to get on the committee because he dropped the buku bucks. But the fact of the matter is, the church voted to put Warren on the committee because of his commitment to the ministry and demonstrating the love of Jesus. And there's a lesson there, my brothers and my sisters. Sometimes we can just try to hoard power and position, but that's not what God expects of us. God expects us to be humble. And if we look as disciples of Christ, what better place can we look for an example to our Lord and our Savior, Jesus Christ himself? A little bit further along in Philippians chapter 2, between verses 6 and 11, the Bible reminds us that even though Jesus was one with God, even though Jesus was in the form of God, even though Jesus was God in the form of human flesh, that Jesus did not count equality with God as something to be grasped, as something to be exploited. But the Bible says that Jesus emptied himself, took on the form of a servant, took on the form of a slave, and became obedient to the point of death, even death upon the cross. And that's the penultimate example of how God exalts the humble, because it goes on in Philippians 2 to say that God gave Jesus a name that is above every other name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. The penultimate example of how God exalts the humble. In the hymn, No Not One, that second stanza said is something like this: no friend like him is so high and holy. No, not one. No, not one. But yet no friend is so meek and lowly. No, not one. No, not one. My brothers and my sisters in Christ Jesus, we ought to all have that mindset to be humble. Instead of going out and trying to pray like the Pharisee, we ought to all be like the tax collector and just say, God, be merciful to me. I believe in the second stanza of the Fanny Crosby hymn, Pass Me Not, O Gentle Savior, she had the right idea. Let me at the throne of mercy find a sweet relief, kneeling there in deep contrition, help my unbelief. Savior, Savior, hear my humble cry. That's the mindset that we ought to have. I believe that the hymn writer Kenneth Morris had the right idea. when he penned the words, "There are some folk who look and long for this world's riches. There are some folk who look for power, position too. But I have Christ all in my life. This makes me happy, for Christ is all in all, this world to me." Beloved, remember the lesson of the parable, that those who humble themselves will be exalted, and those who exalt themselves will be humbled. I'd rather humble myself and have God exalt me than to try to puff myself up and have God have to humble me. God resists the proud, but gives grace to the humble. Remember, my brothers and my sisters, God exalts the humble. Christ is all. Without him, nothing could be. Christ is all. All in all, this world to me. Beloved, humble obedience. That's what Jesus asked for. That short parable that we expounded on today, 6 verses in duration, set a simple example of how God exalts the humble. The parable right after it in the scripture, in Luke chapter 18, verses 15 through 17, it's a little short parable. It just said Jesus blesses the children. And as we listen to the little buds lead us in our music ministry today, and looked at our youth leading us in our worship experience, we are reminded that that short parable that follows the one that was in the lectionary today reminds us that children are an example of how we follow Jesus in humble obedience. That's the meaning of that parable too, that we give ourselves, we give our lives to Jesus, we profess our faith in Jesus with humble obedience. There may be somebody who wants to give his or her life to Christ this afternoon. There may be somebody who wants to follow the example of that Pharisee and just say, "God, be merciful to me, a sinner." There may be somebody who wants to ask Jesus to forgive you of your sins, ask Jesus to save your soul. It's really easy, friends, and it's not hard at all. We make things so much more complicated than they need to be. Romans 10:9, if you confess with your mouth that Jesus Christ is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. It's just that simple. If there's someone who wants to commit your life to Christ this afternoon, you can unmute and voice your pen, your desire now, or you can type a public or private message in the chat if you're watching us on Zoom. If you'd rather do something more personal or more one-on-one with the pastor, you can call me or text me at 201-736-9107. Or you can send me a private message through the social medium of your choice, be it Facebook, be it LinkedIn, be it Instagram, be it Snapchat, amen, be it Twitter. On Twitter, I'm Preaching Terp. On all my other social media, it's just Kevin Agee. Please feel free to reach out. We'd be more than happy to receive you in the body of Christ. If you're already a part of the body of Christ and you want to recommit or rededicate your life to the Lord this afternoon, or if you feel calling on your life to preach the gospel or to exhort or to start a new ministry in God's church, same means. You can express your desire now, or you can call me or text me, or you can send me a private message through the aforenamed social media. Last but not least, if you're watching or listening this afternoon and you're in need of a church home, we would love to have you here at Russell Temple. We're not perfect people. We're sinners saved by grace. Amen. We are sinners saved by grace, and still know that even though we're saved, we need God's mercy. Isn't that right? We just want to share the love of Jesus with our brothers and our sisters. My friends, even though we're still worshiping electronically and virtually for a little while longer, don't make any mistake. Don't get it twisted. The doors of the church are still wide open on the hinges of welcome. Is there one who will come to Christ this afternoon? Is there one who will join the church this afternoon? The doors of the church are wide open. My friends, we pray God's blessings upon you. We pray that the Lord will bless and keep you. If there are those who still want to make a commitment to Christ or to reach out, or if you just want to talk to the pastor, we invite you to reach out personally, one-on-one. At this time, we'd like to go before God's grace in prayer. A couple of prayer requests we saw in the chat at the beginning of worship. That's Sister Doris Thorne's youngest grandchild is in urgent care. We pray God's healing. We pray God's healing upon that youngest grand. We also received a prayer request toward the end of the week that Brother Odell Sherman's brother's father-in-law, Brother Lenny Canton, was in the hospitalized. And, you know, we just pray God's healing upon Brother Canton. Amen. We pray God's healing upon all of our brothers and sisters facing health challenges. We pray God's comfort, strength, and peace upon all of our brothers and sisters who've experienced loss and grief. Let us now, beloved, prepare to go before God's throne of grace in prayer. Let every heart pray. Lord our God, we thank you for your grace and your mercy. We thank you, Lord, for the encouragement of your holy word to come boldly before the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and that we may find grace to help in the time of need. We thank you and praise you, dear Lord, for hearing and answering the prayers of your people. We thank you, dear Lord, for the assurance of your holy word, that the prayer of a righteous person is powerful and effective. Lord, we thank you and praise you that we don't have to have a lot of eloquent words to share. Lord God, as long as prayer is sincere and humble, Lord, we thank you that all we have to do is follow the example of the tax collector in this morning's parable and just say, God, be merciful to me, a sinner, and know that you will answer our prayers. We thank you, O Lord, for the assurance of the hymn writer who said, now let us have a little talk with Jesus. Tell him all about our troubles. He will hear our faintest cry, and he will answer by and by. And when you feel a little prayer wheel turning, you'll know a little fire is burning, and find a little talk with Jesus makes it right. Thank you, Lord, that all of us can come before you in prayer. Thank you, O God, for the assurance that you will hear all of our prayers, any one of our prayers, as long as we pray to you with a sincere heart. Lord God, we lift up Sister Doris' grandchild to you. We lift up Brother Sherman's brother's father-in-law to you. Lord God, we lift up all of our brothers and sisters facing health challenges. Lord God, we lift up all bereaved families. Lord God, we lift up all of our brothers and sisters facing various trials and tribulations. Thank you, dear Lord, for being our refuge and our strength, a very present help in trouble. And, oh, Lord, our God, we just thank you and we praise you just because of who you are. Because of who you are, we give you glory. Because of who you are, we give you praise. Because of who you are, we just lift our voices and say, Lord, I worship you because of who you are, Jehovah Jireh, my provider, Jehovah Nisi. Lord, you reign in victory. Jehovah Shalom, my Prince of Peace. Lord, we worship because of who you are. Hear our prayers, O Lord. Hear our prayers, O Lord. Incline thine ear to us and grant us thy peace. In the precious name of Jesus our Christ, we pray. And the church said, amen.
Happy day.
Oh, happy day.
Amen. Hallelujah. Oh, happy day. Amen. Before worship this morning, I had to send a tech team a message. They jamming for Jesus with that oh, happy day. Amen. If Pastor had some rhythm, he'd have been dancing over here. Amen. Instead of just having the head bop. But y'all get that ready for next week. Next week's sermon is on washing sin, staying away. So y'all get that old happy day ready for the sermonic selection for next Sunday. Amen. Oh, happy day. That version, the Hawkins singers. Amen. Amen. Praise God. We need all sorts of genre of sacred music in the church. Amen. Not just the old hymns that us old heads, but we need some contemporary too. Isn't that right? Praise God. Folk lost their minds when that song first came out. It was on the pop charts. Amen. Not just the gospel charts. It was on the pop charts. Amen. And you know, every generation, folk lost their mind the same way when Mary Mary came out with Shackles and Kirk Franklin came out with Stomp, and they were playing them on the urban contemporary radio stations and the hip hop stations. And folk lost their natural minds, amen. But you know, every now and then we need to jam for Jesus too, isn't that right? Hallelujah, amen. Everybody ought to praise the Lord. You know, when you read Psalm 50, there are all kinds of different ways to praise the Lord, not just with the psaltery and the harp, but we praise God with the loud clanging cymbals, isn't that right? Praise the Lord with the dance, hallelujah, amen. All right, I ain't gonna preach again, amen. I'm just saying what I'm saying, like Bishop Hoyt used to say. A couple of quick commercials and we're done. First, I want to call your attention, homecoming. Now, please note the third Sunday, so November 20th instead of November 13th. Matter of fact, I'll be at a mortgage burning for one of our other churches on the 13th, but we'll be having homecoming on the 20th, and we're looking forward to it. Praise God. The next meeting of the reopening task force will be tomorrow evening at 6 o'clock on Zoom. We've already sent the Zoom link out to the committee. We look forward to sharing with you. Today, we're wearing the color purple, not just because it represents penitence and fasting, even though we all need to confess and repent and fast, not just because Advent's coming in a few weeks, but we're wearing purple today in commemoration of Domestic Violence Awareness Month. There are a number of awarenesses that we observe in the month of October. One of those is domestic violence. My brothers and my sisters, domestic violence is far more commonplace than you may think. I will say that more than 95% of reported cases of domestic violence are with a male perpetrator and a female victim, amen. But we all know that you can't have same gender domestic violence. You can also have, you know, female or male domestic violence. I mean, no matter who, domestic violence is inappropriate. Just so happens that when I pastored at Syracuse, I was an honorary chairperson 1 year of what we call the White Ribbon Campaign. And basically what it was an effort for men to hold men accountable for not only falling into temptation to be domestically violent toward their wives and significant others, but also to call other men to accountability for their domestic violence. We used to have a little slogan, a little jingle that was no excuse for abuse. Somebody ought to type no excuse for abuse in the chat. Amen. There's no excuse for abuse. And I noticed there was a slide there. I noticed the address was, you know, in Connecticut. But, you know, in every community, there's some type of organization. There's some type of organization that operates shelters, you know, for persons who are victims of domestic violence. And, you know, they do things very carefully. You know, if you're trying to help somebody to get out of an abusive situation, you know, they have the nonprofit organization will assign, you know, advocates for the person who's the victim of domestic violence, help the person develop a plan, a financial plan, and all types of other plans to get out of the situation. Because sometimes when somebody tries to escape from the abuse, sometimes the abuser will get so angry that they'll try to, you know, they'll even threaten to do violence, threaten to do harm, or threaten the life of the person. So we need to take that into consideration. But, you know, if you know somebody in your circle who is in an abusive situation, help you, the person you love, to get out of the abusive situation before it's too late. I mean, I'm not going to take a straw poll. Many of us probably have loved ones who've either been injured or died due to injuries from domestic violence. So it's something that we want to definitely fight against, and we want to get people out of harm's way. And even though I focus on the physical nature of domestic violence, let me say one more thing. Not all violence is physical. You don't have to beat or slap somebody or shoot or cut somebody in order to be violent. Sometimes you can be violent with your speech. Hello, somebody. Sometimes your words could be violent. Abusive language is a form of violence, amen. Either withholding, you know, withholding things that somebody needs, like withholding money, withholding food, withholding affection or other things, all of that is also violent, amen. So violence is not just physical. Violence can also be verbal. Violence can be psychological, and violence can be emotional. My brothers and my sisters, let us combat violence. Let us combat domestic abuse. No excuse for abuse. Amen. Praise God. Last but not least, my beloved, for Bible study this week, we'll begin with Acts chapter 3, and I'm going to split it up somewhat the way we split up chapter 2 this week. We're going to look at Peter and John healing the crippled man at the gate called Beautiful, Acts chapter 3, verses 1 through 10. Then the following week, we'll look at another one of Peter's speeches slash sermons in Acts chapter 3, verses 11 to 26. So homework for this week's Bible study is verses 1 through 10, and then we'll look at verses 11 through 26 the following week. God bless you. Heaven smile upon you. Have a wonderful weekend. Oh, I forgot my voting commercial. Beloved, please vote. Amen. Please vote. We're getting closer to election day, getting close to the end, to the end of early voting, getting close to the deadline for mail-in voting and absentee ballots, provisional ballots. And my brothers and my, it's important that you vote, not only for specific candidates, but vote for issues too. I just read an article in between church, school, and service this morning that remind us that there are five states. Can you believe in 2022, we still got states that are so archaic and so asinine and so racist that it's still legal to have slaves in those states? There are five states when voters will have opportunities to vote slavery off, out of the laws. Amen, all together. Hello, somebody. There are five states where folk can eliminate slavery in this year's election. So brothers and sisters, voting matters, not only for candidates, not only national elections, but your state elections, your county elections, those who have county government, and your local elections, they matter. Also, pay attention to the issues, amen? Pay attention to the referendums, amen? Vote everything on your ballot, amen? And follow the instructions directly, amen? Praise God. Help get some souls to the polls between now and November 8th. And in that same vein, tonight at 8 o'clock Eastern Time, 7 o'clock Central Time, Bishop Marvin Frank Thomas, amen. I see Sister Doris had already voted. I know some others voted early already too. God bless you, all you who already voted early. Yeah, get some other souls to the polls, amen. But tonight, good trouble, in the words of the late Congressman John Lewis, good trouble. With Bishop Marvin Frank Thomas Sr., Bishop Charlie Haynes. You can watch it live tonight at 8 o'clock Eastern, 7 Central on the CME Facebook page. And those of you who like to watch Dr. Skip Mason, there's a conversation this afternoon with the first four elected bishops from this year's General Conference. You're going to be able to see Bishop Clarence Kelby Heath, Bishop Denise Anders Modest, Bishop Charlie Haynes Jr., and our own Bishop Ricky D. Helton. You'll be able to see an interview with the four of them at 5 o'clock Eastern Time on the CME Facebook page with Dr. Skip Mason. God bless you. Heaven smile upon you. Have a wonderful week. God be with you till we meet again. I think now we're ready. Thank you, Sister Ronnie, for listing some of those states in the chat. Amen. God be with you till we meet again. Amen. Now to doxology and the benediction.
Yeah.
Amen. Hallelujah. Now may the grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all, now and forevermore. And all the people said, Amen.